Today, our world is home to people who are already consuming more natural resources than our planet can sustainably offer. And by 2030, when the global population has reached 8.3 billion, urbanization and increased standards of living, especially in emerging markets, will see our consumption double. Which means, if we continue to live as we do now, by 2030, we will need the resources of three planets. But we only have one.
Around the world now, we pull out of the ground a half trillion tons of stuff a year, put them through various resource-crunching activities, and then throw them away. Of all that stuff, less than 1% ever winds up in a product and is still there 6 months after sale. All the rest is waste.
We live in times of profound transformation, marked by a crisis of sustainability. A centuries-old modern industrial world is coming to an end, and a new world is being born. This emerging world of the 21st century is complex, systemic, interconnected, ever-evolving. It requires new ways of thinking.
Typically, human beings look at things in a very narrow frame. This is what's my job. I take this, I do this to it, and I put it here, and it goes away. Sustainability, in essence, is a systems view of a life cycle. How things are taken, how they're manufactured, how they're moved, how they're used, and how they're disposed of.
So if all the way back at the beginning, where you designed the thing in the first place, you thought about what's going to happen to it when it gets to the end user, you start to see all of this waste, and you start to see the opportunities to squeeze the waste out of the system.
Potential is everywhere, both bright and dark.
The next 10 years will prove whether we have what it takes. Amidst a rapidly warming climate, we all need to make a change. We, however, feel hope. Hope that by looking at the world in a new way, we will conquer the challenges ahead. This is called systems-based thinking. It is integrating everything we do, from how we move around to how we interact with the natural world into a coherent whole. It's looking at the world from the seat of a train, or the streets of a village, or the perspective of a drop of water, and understanding how it all ties together.
Systems thinking means understanding how systems are interconnected, as well as understanding the dynamics within systems. A system is a configuration of parts connected and joined together by a web of relationships or networks. Systems thinking is nonlinear. This means that in systems, cause and effect are not necessarily linked or connected with simple step-by-step chains. Connections between human and natural systems are of particular interest because they offer excellent examples of cascading effects. Cascading effects means that what might seem to be a simple outcome of a given system can actually have a series of effects on other interconnected systems.
Discovered by Dutch scientist Christian Huygens in 1665, systems theory proposes that in one way or another, everything is connected to each other in one overall system. Fish and starlings use it as a survival mechanism, and it can be applied to studies from biology to engineering.
People are not particularly well equipped for systems thinking. It's much easier to understand and interact with simple, linear cause and effect chains. The more complex the system dynamics, the more difficult it is to know how decisions will play out. Oftentimes, decisions or actions at one point have an impact on another component within the system. Within systems thinking, it is important to see the interconnected nature of all the elements and to understand that reacting to a problem in one part of the system may have unintended consequences on other components or the process as a whole. Systems thinking does not claim complete knowledge, Rather, systems thinking is about assessing the degree of system complexity, analyzing system dynamics, and making decisions that reduce the risk of negative outcomes.
The systems that you are part of and that you care about are complex. They're made up of many independent and connected parts, and they're adaptive. Their parts are constantly adjusting, refining, converting, integrating, based on what is happening in the world around them. We can learn a lot about how to design and implement complex adaptive systems from the experts, from nature, things like ants, birds, and fish.
These ants are working in tandem to form a bridge. Even though there's no leader giving orders, they all seem to know what to do. Similarly, thousands of starlings fly in unison, creating complex formations in the sky. Magnetic properties arise from the alignment of billions of electrons. Intricate frost patterns crystallize on window panes. Hurricanes form above churning oceans, and once clear highways suddenly get jammed with traffic. These different systems all share something in common. Some sort of macro property or behavior arises spontaneously from many interacting micro parts. It's a classic case of the whole being greater than the sum of its parts. The behavior of each of those parts doesn't predict how they behave collectively. Let's return to the bridge-building ants. The ants as individuals obey the same behavioral rules, no matter what they're doing. They aren't trying to build structures, but when the ground drops away in front of the swarm, old rules about how close to stay to their neighbors leads to the emergence of large-scale, coordinated behavior. Without that information about their neighbors, the bridge would break apart. Emergence means that we can find hierarchies of new laws and structures that arise out of complexity at different scales.
The famous political prognosticator Nate Silver wrote a book called The Signal and the Noise, and in that book he had a chapter called Becoming Less and Less and Less Wrong. And that's what systems thinking can help us do. The purpose of systems thinking is to help us to be clear about our assumptions, to surface, make them explicit, test them, and improve them so that over time we become less and less and less wrong. And the value of that is we become more and more and more effective. Let me give you an example of this.
Systems thinking is complex because it's not a thing. It's a way of thinking and acting. It's the interrelations between things which are invisible. If we imagine looking through a lens, we can begin to get an idea of what a system looks like. There are multiple systems that influence our everyday lives, like workplaces or schools, and others like the media, food, education, planning, or health systems. We want to understand how systems work, be adaptive and reflective in the way we work by intervening both at different points simultaneously to produce multiplier effects and at strategic leverage points for greatest impact. But we're not alone as actors within the system. We're acting and reacting to multiple influences and interests. As soon as you do something within a system, it responds. This is why we're agile, fluid, and adaptive in our response. Practice, policy, and research interact through feedback of knowledge in the system. With this understanding of complex systems, we're evolving to broader, sustained actions for the whole population, where they live, work, learn, and play. Working within the system means working across levels, locally, across the state, and nationally. Because it's not just about what we're doing, it's about what everyone's doing.
We don't really think about the implications of our actions over broader space and time dimensions. And that, quite frankly, is what systems thinking can help us do better. Look around you. You'll see many examples of unintended consequences. For years, we've been using antibacterial products, antibiotics, soap. What's happened, though, is that the bacteria that has survived tends to be stronger. When communities face increased traffic congestion, they build more roads. Seems to work for a short time, but what happens is further out, suburbs become more attractive, people move there, and the roads get congested again. Corporations, when they get behind or have profitability problems, might work their employees harder. Short run, they may get more results. In the long run, though, people get burned out from stress, more likely to either create errors, create problems, or quit. Again, negative consequences. And these happen in all facets of life. We use our mental models to take appropriate action. If I want this to happen, what should I do? Where is it the most important place for me to focus my energies and attention? If I do this, what will happen as a result? Those are places where we'd apply our mental models. In the case of the biggest issues that we're trying to solve, obesity and chronic disease and other kinds of issues like that, we want to make a huge difference. What we're looking for is what I call high leverage. Let's define high leverage as the ability to fundamentally improve the performance of a system while simultaneously reducing the likelihood of negative, unintended consequences. Ultimately, system thinking requires we possess a certain amount of humility, realizing that we can never possess the truth. The best we can do is become less and less and less wrong.
All our societal systems must be fitted within the carrying capacity of our environment. We need significant changes in our housing, energy, mobility, and food systems. This is the only way by which we can combat climate change and biodiversity loss and secure a good future.
One theory about change that is relevant for addressing complex issues like climate change and peak oil is the multi-level perspective of sociological transitions, or MLP for short. MLP provides insights into how one technology has transitioned to a radically new one to fulfill a social need. Let's look at how that applies to the car and personal transport. The central idea of MLP is that a technology, such as a car, does not exist as a discrete entity. Rather, as the car became a dominant means of transport, the car develops interdependencies with social, technical, and institutional factors, including production and supply chain systems, car users, regulation, and infrastructure and culture, creating a system called a socio-technological regime. The factors and their interdependencies in this regime over time lock society into the dominant technological solution. So, how does this happen? First, as a technology like the car matures, people working in the industry, the car designers, research managers, engineers and so forth, tend to develop common assumptions, knowledge, beliefs and habits about what are possible and legitimate transport solutions. Second, car manufacturers and their suppliers will try to protect their investments and market share. The economies of scale that have developed in producing cars also prevents new transport technologies competing with them. Third, financial investors and insurers of technologies are often skeptical of new technologies, making it difficult for innovators to get financial capital. And in New Zealand, this is particularly so for the commercialisation stage of new innovations. Fourth, the built environments such as suburbs and roads have co-evolved with a private car. Oil was cheap up to the early 1970s, which led to major motorway expansions and the creation of suburbia around many cities, and today most of us rely on private cars to drive to work and get around. As the built environment is long-lived and expensive to change, we get locked into a dependency on private motorised cars. Fifth, our lifestyles and attitudes co-evolve with the evolution of the car as the dominant means of transport. We've got used to driving where and whenever we want, and expect to continue to do so. And this influences which transport technologies are seen as socially acceptable. We have collectively created symbolic associations with the car, reinforced by media and popular culture. For example, cars are symbols of individual freedom and successes, while wearing lycra and riding a bike is not. Finally, even when we want to switch to another transport option, we develop habits and routines connected to our cars which we find hard to break. And then there's public policies such as taxation and regulation which also co-evolve with the dominant technology, often creating an uneven playing field for other technologies to compete. In New Zealand, policy has privileged motorised cars by not charging drivers all transport externalities. For example, the public cost of vehicle-related water and air pollution and carbon dioxide emissions. So, a new transport technology does not just have to compete with the car, but it has to compete with the whole system of social, physical and institutional factors that have co-evolved with the car. And this tends to lock society into this technology trajectory, even when it has become suboptimal. So, how do radical technological innovations succeed? Well, first, the current transport system has to be disrupted. Pressures and events at what MLP refers to as the landscape level occur and put pressure on the current system or regime. Pressures may include changes to society's dominant values and beliefs, and events such as wars and natural disasters. For example, growing concern over climate change has gradually pushed climate change onto political agendas, raising consumer concern and creating policies which collectively disrupt the car's symbolic and financial position. These landscape disruptions create windows of opportunity for new and radical innovations to gain market share. Radical innovations are often referred to as technological niches which develop in protected spaces within the regime. But if a niche is not mature enough when a window opens, it won't be able to take advantage of it. Timing is critical. If the niche is mature enough, then it may either replace the regime by competing with it, for example, electric public transport, or be subsumed into the regime as a means of reducing the landscape pressure, for example, hybrid cars. This latter adoption, however, might over time push the incumbent regime trajectory in a new direction, for example, further stimulating electric vehicle development. When we develop a richer understanding of how social and technological change occurs, we can stimulate new ideas to create change for a sustainable future, for government policy, for business practice and innovation, and for communities.
New innovations and experiments trigger sustainability transformations. Innovations multiply and scale up as technology, practices, rules, and even professions change. In this way, sustainability transformations advance in systems and the entire society changes. The change should be based on research and be carried through in a fair manner. Making sustainability transformation happen needs the administration and companies of all areas and researchers and all of us to join these efforts.
We may only have 10 years, but the future is ours to create. Let's get going.